Happy birthday, Paul. 60.
Wow.
As we set out to create our contribution to this little tribute, our intent was to paint a picture that helped us all, especially the children, better understand Paul. Our hope is our little story flows effortlessly between heartfelt, funny, and maybe a little mean, but always meant to be funny. And we will make a special attempt to avoid shocking and embarrassing. Before I continue, I also want to both thank and apologize on behalf of all of us to Linda. We thank her for her vision and the work assignment that we so enjoyed, while apologizing for ignoring all of her failed attempts to micromanage us.
I am sorry.
For me, the Paul Brogan story started on Apple Road in Newark, Delaware when I was in the fourth grade. Paul's dad was recently transferred to Newark, and they moved in literally in my backyard. At that time, Chris Brown and I were kind of joined at the hip, but Paul quickly worked his way into our little circle. Who knew that that backyard connection would lead to lifelong friendships? We spent the next 5 years growing up together, formative years. There's so many memories. We played a lot of football, baseball, basketball. At one point, we even built a golf course in my yard with closely mown greens.
This is a hybrid. This is a cross, bluegrass, Kentucky bluegrass, featherbed bench, and Northern California Sensimilla.
We used wiffle golf balls, of course. I don't recall who won, but I'm sure it was me. We had a blast. We walked to West Park Elementary School for the fourth and fifth grades together. All of that action took place on Apple Road. The park was really just a tract of woods that abutted the railroad tracks, but we'd spend countless hours there. It was the time of Evel Knievel, who inspired us to build ramps for jumping our stingrays over creeks. Although neither of us really had stingrays, we had cheap knockoffs that we always had to fix. So that leads me to possibly the most infamous, memorable, and most talked about childhood story of all time. One that has lasted generations with an outcome that is still in dispute.
Yeah, you keep telling me that.
I don't recall what year this was, but the scene is set, of course, in the circle. Chris, Paul, and I were chatting, and Paul, always the instigator, somehow conceived a challenge, which Chris was happy to attempt. The wager was set at $20.
I got $20 in my pocket.
Nothing was agreed in writing. Here was the plan. We would get an old bike. Of course, we chose Mike Brogan's bike without his prior consent. Mike's bike was to be parked in the circle, and Chris was to start in front of my house, work up to top speed, and ram Mike's bike broadside. It was brilliant.
Failure is not an option.
Bicycle, bicycle, bicycle.
I want to ride my...
Chris hopped on his bike. Without any hesitation, he worked his way up to top speed. Bang! A direct hit on Mike's bike. Of course, Chris goes flying over the handlebars, takes a couple of hard rolls on the circle's pavement before ending up on the grass in the park. Chris collects himself for a minute before running home crying.
Stop crying.
To the naked eye, you would say, wow, Paul owes Chris $20. And his brother Mike an apology. Well, of course, there wasn't a referee, and this was long before replay cameras. So Paul's view, which he maintains to this day, is that Chris did not win the bet, because he stopped pedaling just a millisecond before impact. Which, to be fair, is exactly how I saw it. He did stop. But most rational people conclude that the spirit of the challenge was achieved. The drama, of course, continued throughout the day. Mike Brown, so incensed by the injustice, marched over to the Brogan's house and demanded the $20 from Mrs. Brogan, which was never paid. And there you go. The controversy lives to this day. A possible solution, and I did some math assuming in 1975 was the year of this incident, Paul, you would owe Chris $97.77. So maybe after all these years, he can cancel that wager as a 60th birthday gift.
So, after hearing this fabulous tale of woe and back and forth, I suggest, Paul, we settle this silly debate and make a contribution to a good cause for both of us. In my case, I'd like to make it to the breast cancer, so any of the funds that generated the result of this settlement should be contributed to the Breast Cancer Foundation. Hope that works. Be well. Happy 60.
So I'll share one more middle school memory. We were in eighth grade. Mr. Ferguson was our school principal, and he interrupts my math class and asks me to step into the office, where I was promptly suspended for an incident involving squirting food dye on a kid that was kind of an asshole.
Oh, Doyle rules!
Earlier the same day, Paul thought it would be really funny to stand at the top of the stairwell between classes and squirt the same dye down the steps. I'm sure neither of us were proud of our decisions that day. So while I'm sitting in the office waiting for my mom to pick me up, I see Mr. Ferguson walking in with Paul. And I'll always remember the look on his face when I said, "Did you get suspended too?" After arriving home, post-suspension, Joan and Glenda got together and sentenced us to backyard fall cleanup duty. So we ended up having a pretty good day in that backyard together.
Paul's first stint in Newark ended in the summer of 1975 as the Brogan family loaded up the Chrysler station wagon and headed for Memphis, Tennessee.
Paul disappeared for the next 4 years, and I'm not sure what happened down there, but it's pretty clear to me that the Christian Brothers were not quite finished with him.
Paul returned to Newark in the winter of 1980, enrolling in the university. Paul was praised for his study habits, often seen sneaking off to Morris Library, Daugherty Hall, and the business school for quiet time to focus on his studies.
So Paul entered my life as a second semester freshman year. It's at when we were at Dickinson dorms. And I had befriended Mr. Baggett and Mr. Brown in the first semester, and Mr. Brown's replacement came in, and he was kind of this southern, even though I heard he was from Newark, he seemed like he was more from Memphis. He brought this chewing tobacco hawking with him. I think later we'll look back and say that Paul was sort of the supplier to got us all sort of involved with this slight addiction, which most of us have mainly kicked. But Paul was this sweet southern kid that we met freshman year. The second year we were at school, we all lived together in Seifert, a group of us. We had three in one room on the lower level and three at the top level. The lower level got expelled about a month in because of a few words Mr. Kozel said at a party one night. But Paul and Bag's room upstairs, and I'll say it that way because they held the parties, and they held the parties all the time. I mean, we got kicked out in early October, so if you want to think about that, at least through the end of the first semester.
Grab a brew. Don't cost nothing.
And what I remember is the Lola songs.
That's the way that I wanted to stay. I always wanted to be that way for my Lola.
The pylons, which I think Paul initiated late in the evening when everybody jumped on the pile together, guys and girls.
Boys and boys will be girls.
And then Pat O'Connor's window ledge walks, which didn't always turn out great as he fell on at least one occasion. Paul was the nice guy at Delaware. You know, Paul was, we would say Paul would disappear late at night, but I think most of us thought Paul was doing something, you know, nice, like helping an old lady across the street or getting to bed early, or Paul was generally deemed as being the nice one.
He seems like a nice guy.
But one day, one night actually, when we were walking by President Trubant's window, Paul, in a un-Paul-like moment, hurled a beer bottle, and it was a great throw. It was one of the better throws I think I saw, even by all the good quarterbacks we had at Delaware playing football. It hit the upper window, probably the bedroom window, on the left side facing the front door. But he fortuitously seemed to have hit the frame between the upper and the lower window, and it bounced off and smashed on the ground. It didn't break the window.
Tonight, the bottle let me down.
And in that moment, it made Paul more human. It made him more like the rest of us troubled youth. It made him less invincible, and he joined the gang with that hurl to the top window. And Paul's been a great friend ever since. He's actually gotten more reckless as he's gotten older, crashing his mountain bike all the time. But anyway, Paul, happy 60th. You're the best. Look forward to having a few drinks, and even mountain biking as timidly as I do.
Hey, Paul, Jamie Mosco. Happy 60th birthday. I cannot believe this is the year of 60. Wasn't it just recently when you all were climbing through my dorm room window at Smythe And who had the moped, you or Bags? Anyway, we always had such fun times, and it's always been great throughout the years to catch up with you and Linda. So I hope you have a happy 60th birthday, and hopefully I'll see you soon.
August of 1981 found the boys moving into the burg. It was here that Paul would discover MTV, HBO, ESPN, and the Responsibility Box. His misguided love for these would cost him a trip back to AAA Memphis for the spring of 82. Despite his strong automotive heritage, Paul had his share of problems with cars, particularly with this Olds Cutlass.
Paul Brogan turning 60 this year. It's been 40 years since he wrecked my car. I haven't seen a dime or any type of remuneration for it. Do you even know what that word means?
I'm an excellent driver.
Yeah, that's good. Come on, come on.
He later claimed this never would have happened in a Chrysler product.
First time I met Paul, he was going into sixth grade. I met the Brogans in the backyard. And it was just love at first sight having an Irish family move in. I always adored your mother so much, and we got to know Jim through her, because Joan and I were stay-at-home moms and we had plenty of children at that point to keep us very occupied.
Oh, Paul, yeah, sure. But when he was a kid, he had a real nice smile, always seemed happy. He had a twinkle in his eye, though, that led me to give some second thoughts to him later. Then, as the boys got a little older, of course, as boys do, there's trouble sometimes in the neighborhood. And nobody knows who did what or anything. And it seemed to me that Paul was always sort of in the center of it. Maybe he had a little more to do with the trouble than could be proven. But in our hearts and to the rest of the world, he's just a wonderful kid. But he had a good family, too. His father was really, both mother and father were just really wonderful people. His dad was very cool guy. He was so nice that the neighborhood, the women at least in the neighborhood, called him Mr. Wonderful.
We did.
And he was such a nice guy, the rest of us who couldn't even compete anyway, we never felt jealous of that at all. He deserved it. He was just a great guy to talk with, great guy to know, and I'm sure he was a wonderful father, and I'm sure that he would be very proud of, I know he's proud, he was proud of all his children, and I know he'd be very proud of all of them.
You knew Jim better than I did, of course, and I knew Joan because we had sewing projects together. We made costumes for kids. We just name it. I loved them very much, as I love you, Paul, and have a wonderful, wonderful birthday. And may this, I always say, every decade gets better, and believe me, it does.